It's the first show of the new year for the Wellness Architect Show. This is your boy, Kevin Thornton, the Wellness Architect. 2017 is going to be a great year. And how I thought about doing it is by having us change our energy levels and change any kind of energy blockage or any kind of energy healing. Those who know me know that I'm a firm believer that we all are energy. Everything is energy. So, you know, we want to elevate our energy levels as high as we can so we could attract the abundance of love, life, relationships, wellness, and health. So I have a special guest today that I'm going to have him introduce himself to you. But before I do that, I have two couple things I want to remind everybody on. So this new year, this is going to be the first month. Those who are still interested in doing the book club, the first book for the month of this month of January is going to be The Alchemist. So those who are interested, please inbox me on Facebook, and then I will create a group page, and we will discuss the book as you read it, and then we will discuss it online, me on the show as well. Also, I want us to give a shout out to all those who are doing the 90-day weight loss challenge. So today they're doing their detox phase, so I want to give you a good shout out to them. And so today's show is gonna be very, very good. I've been watching this guy. He doesn't know this. I've been watching this guy for a minute. He has some great posts. He's very, very in tune with his inner spirit. And I've been trying to figure out when would be the best time to have him on the show. And it's nothing like the best time when on the very first show of the year, so we can, you know, talk about quantum energy healing. So I want to introduce you to Mr. Jason Hairston. Welcome to the show. Thank you, sir. Not a problem. So tell everybody who you are, where you from, and how you get to become who you are.
Okay. My name is Jason Hairston. Said I'm a quantum energy healer, and I'm also a self-mastery coach.
Okay, what's that?
So a self-mastery coach is going through a process of unblocking all of the things that may be holding you back from reaching your fullest potential.
Okay.
Discovering the gifts within yourself that you may not see for yourself.
Okay.
Teaching you how to learn how to find the lessons within pain instead of choosing to be a victim of pain.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all about tuning into the experience and understanding and decoding the experience. So I'm not self-mastered, but I practice self-mastery every day because I'm aware of my feelings and what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So because I'm aware and I know that I don't have to react and I can choose to respond instead, I am choosing to be a self-master in that moment when I do so. So I teach my clients how to do the same, and the result is a more peaceful, efficient way of living.
Okay. So go ahead. I'm sorry.
So where am I from? So,
yeah.
Well, interesting story. I was actually born in California.
Okay.
We left California when I was 3 years old. Went back to Youngstown, Ohio.
Okay.
I was raised where most of my family is.
Okay.
Moved to Atlanta in 99. I lived here for 13 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then I moved to Cali, stayed there for a year and a half. Then I started traveling the world. Then I came back to Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
They called me back. So
okay.
I'm back here to do some work.
All right.
For now.
All right. You sound like me. So you are an Ohio boy,
Midwest.
So am I, Cleveland, Ohio. So that's one of the things. That's one of the things. That's why I saw when I saw that. I said, okay, he's a good guy. So how did you start doing quantum energy healing and self mastery coaching?
Okay. Yes. So as far as the energy healing, in 2008, a friend of mine took me to a workshop where this guy did energy healing. I've never seen it before.
Mm-hmm.
So when I saw him, and she volunteered, so I knew it wasn't fake.
Mm-hmm.
And he was moving energy through her body, and her body was responding.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, wow, this is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I need to learn how to do this.
Right.
So at the time, this was 2008, so I was kind of in my ego.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted to learn how to do this so I could use it when I date women. Like,
right. Yeah.
It was very egotistical at first, but over time, so let me just back up a little bit though. So after I saw that, I started to practice, you know, moving energy, and eventually I started doing it. But other events started to happen in my life to show me that this is actually a sacred art and it's nothing to be played with.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was showing those things, I took it upon myself to scale back from doing it from an egotistical point of view, mm-hmm. doing it from a healing point of view, which is what it's meant to be.
Okay.
The foundation of it for healing.
Okay.
So people clear blockages.
Okay.
You know, so from that point, from 2008 on, I just developed my own technique on my own. Nobody ever trained me.
Mm-hmm.
I train other people, but so I knew that when I saw the brother doing the energy healing, it was just an unlocking to a remembering.
Mm-hmm.
I remembered. It's already in me.
Wow.
So it just started coming out on its own, and my energy healing continues to evolve as time goes on.
Mm-hmm.
So now other gifts starts to come through. I can see things. Sometimes I see
mm-hmm.
into people's like past.
Mm-hmm.
Psychic abilities start to kick in. Now,
okay.
Things of that nature. So I just let it evolve naturally,
mm-hmm.
and I stay in the heart with it. Make sure I keep it in the heart space.
Okay.
Every time I whatever service I provide, the foundation of it is love.
Right.
So that is the whole foundation of everything that I do.
Okay.
You know,
so. Cool. Before we even go into quantum energy healing, I want to go, let me pull it up to your Facebook page.
Okay.
I go to mine. And you posted something about 5 hours ago that it resonated with me. And I felt it would be a good start to the conversation. You put, where are you at? All right, so you put, if you are a woman who hates men, you will not be able to build within a relationship with a man. If you are a man who hates women, you will not be able to build within a relationship with a woman. Be honest with your anger. Face it, heal it. The more you lash out at the opposite sex, the more you are lashing out at the energy within yourself. You must love the masculine and the feminine inside as of self before you can build within the harmonious construct of Ma'at with a life partner. I really like that. So can you explain further for those who's listening what that meant?
Yes, definitely. If you really pay attention to our culture and how we look at relationships, what mm-hmm. you notice is, if you truly pay attention, that men are angry mm-hmm. at women and women are angry at men.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of us sitting down face to face and telling each other why we're mad at each other,
mm-hmm.
we just lash out and get triggered. We never get to the root of the reasons.
Right.
So therefore, we turn each other into enemies as opposed to looking at the feelings as an opportunity to get to the root to heal it. So
mm-hmm.
this is why we don't have strong relationships.
Right.
You know, and we've even accepted in our culture that it's natural to be destructive. In a sense.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at all the romantic movies or what have you, you
right.
see a lot of chaos.
Right.
Right. It doesn't have to be that way.
Right.
When I'm relating with my woman, if I get triggered, first of all, if I do react out of anger, I will apologize and say, I'm sorry, but when you said this, it triggered this within me. And I will bring up an insecurity within myself that was triggered and explain in detail why
mm-hmm.
I got angry. And at that point, because we both practice self-mastery, she can help me keep me in check with that which needs to be healed. You know,
mm-hmm.
and I can check myself more, so when that comes up again, instead of reacting the next time, I can catch myself,
mm-hmm.
breathe it out, and not allow myself to be triggered. And when you catch yourself from reacting, this is when you start to break the cycles that you're trapped in.
So, okay, so as a coach myself, and I know what you do, we both are aware that men have a hard time dealing with their inner personal feelings. And in order to do the things that you and I both do, you have to be in tune with your feminine side, and which is something that most men have a problem dealing with. Yep.
You a girl,
mm-hmm.
right? But a woman gives birth to a child. A human being comes out of her body.
Right.
We consider that energy to be weak. Think about that for a second.
Mm-hmm.
If it wasn't for a woman giving birth, we wouldn't be here today. So the fact that we look at feminine energy as being something weak is an indication of how we don't understand what feminine energy really is. It's
mm-hmm.
creative energy.
Right.
It's the energy where it's canvas of all creation, where the womb of creation, where things come out of, but we consider it to be weak because we consider feeling as a man to be weak in a society, mm-hmm. hyper-masculine.
Right.
And this is why I take it upon myself, you know, growing up in Youngstown, Ohio, it's a rough area.
Right.
I grew up on hip-hop and all of that, so I'm using myself as an example to show men that you can still be a man,
right.
be a straight man, and still express a feminine part of yourself by expressing how you feel,
right.
and not be less than a man. You can still be a man and express both sides of yourself.
Right.
So it's about understanding masculine, feminine principles and what that means.
Right.
So I could break down, give some
examples. Could you?
Yeah. What that means. So men and women, we both have masculine and feminine energy within us.
Right. Okay?
So the masculine energy is more of the linear way of thinking. You know, take action, focus.
Mm. Right.
Linear. We're gonna do this. Set the protocol.
Yeah.
Okay? Then the feminine energy is more of the creative. So when a man is a poet or a singer or a writer, he's tapping into the feminine energy, which is the flowy flow energy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. But you can coexist with both of those energies within yourself and honor both of them. And some men may feel more comfortable being more in that feminine energy than masculine, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they're gay.
Right.
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 Some women can feel more comfortable in their masculine, doesn't necessarily mean that they're gay. But yeah. it's about understanding and being comfortable with being comfortable with being a little more over here, a little more over there, as long as you know how to dance within the energy. So for instance, I'll give you an example. Mm. My girlfriend, she's more of the logical. In a relationship, mm. she's more logical and linear. I need time frames. Okay, we're going to set it like this. I'm just like, let's just see what happens and go with the flow.
Right.
So we balance each other in that way. So if you pay attention to all of your relationships, all of the relationships that work well, are the ones that balance each other out.
That's true.
Someone has more of the masculine principle, someone has more of the feminine principle. But within those two principles, you may dance in and out. So sometimes I switch into the masculine to where I'm like, we're going to do this. And then right. she shifts into the feminine.
Right.
So it's a dance. I give her enough room to shift into the masculine. When she does, I shift into my feminine and vice versa.
Right.
So it becomes this harmonious, I always mess that word up.
Right.
It becomes harmony within the dance.
Okay.
You know? But if you're not open to both sides of yourself, you can't dance.
Right. And I think that's the major problem.
Right. We're not dancing. And right. life is all about rhythm.
Yeah.
Everything is
yep.
is music. And
rhythm. That's part of, that's part of one of the laws is the yes. rhythm.
Yes, yes, yes. So if we can understand that and embrace both sides of ourselves, and that's why I said in the post that I see a lot of men, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they have been hurt by a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, and I've done this. You go out there and you become a player because you mm-hmm. hurt. You like, forget it. Well, I'm going to
yep.
just have sex. I'm not going to kiss. I've been there. So
yep.
I know.
Yep.
Right? But why did I do that? Because mm-hmm. a woman hurt me. So
yep.
until I got to a point where I could heal that and let that go and forgive her,
uh-huh.
I couldn't come into a balance within myself to where I could come back to respecting women from a place of being centered.
I agree.
Right? Same thing on the opposite end.
Yep.
A lot of women hate men, you know.
I agree. And since I guess you do the same thing that I do, because it's easy. You know, we could say a lot of things, but if we use ourselves, if we use ourselves as an example, that means we're very authentic. And then it allows the people listening to receive it because we use our own personal experiences. And I did something a year ago in Toco Hills where I had to pray over these seven senses, like any hurt feelings, any resentment, you know, any bad karma, all this kind of stuff. And you had to pray and meditate over it for like 30 minutes. So then once you did that, you go in this room and you pray to God, and whatever you meditated on came up. Well, for me, something came up that I never realized I still was holding bad energy for. I had a young lady who accused me of sexual harassment at my job. So that really changed how I saw women. And like you said, the whole, you know, respect level of women. You know, I loved them, but it was only so far you're going to ever get with me because I never really trusted you. And so once I realized at that time that that was holding me back, I asked the universe to release it. And it felt like I had a ton of bricks just let go of me. And I was like walking on air after I did that. So now I see how I engage with women now. It's much different. You know, I'm a little bit more authentic now. You know, I've always been an authentic person, but I've been allowing myself to be a little bit more vulnerable and let people know who, the true inside who I am. Or be a little bit more expressive, you know, instead of being so hardcore. And so I realized that once I had that shift and that released that energy, it changed the whole dynamic of how I see and deal with women now.
And it also changes the type of women that you attract into your life as well.
Absolutely.
Because as long as you're holding on to that anger towards women, you will continue to attract women that will make you angry.
Yep. Yep.
And that's how it works.
I attracted women who made me angry, and I attracted women who went along with my foolishness. So if I was very closed off, they rocked with that. They never really tried to press it to try to get to me to open up or anything like that. So they were perfect for me at that point because they wouldn't try and get no more from me than what I was willing to give them. And, you know, now I know now that type of person I don't need. I need somebody who's going to, now that I'm more open, I'm able to attract somebody different. That's one I'm willing to give all who I am, and not bits and pieces of me and stuff like that. So yeah.
Right, right. And I think that when it comes to being in relationships, many of us don't feel safe enough to be who we really are because we're afraid of being judged.
Yep.
So we hide parts of ourselves.
Yeah.
So this is why purposely, not only in relationships with my partner, but friendships or what have you, I make sure that I create a space for my friends and family or whoever I'm relating with. I make sure that whatever they tell me, I don't judge them, so
right.
I feel safe enough to open up.
Exactly.
And they could say something I don't agree with, or they could do something that I really don't agree with, but I won't judge them so they feel safe and they can let their guards down. You see, whole demeanor, people's whole demeanor changes when you give them that safe space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny because I have a client, and he dims down who he really is because he does in fear of not being liked. And I said, you can't do that because, you know, you got to be 100% comfortable with who you are and just be who you are, and then allow those people the choice either to like the true version of you or not. And then if they can't, then they are no longer who you meant to be with. But to dumb down who you are and not be your true essence of who you are, you're being unfair to yourself, and you're being unfair to that person because you're being somebody you're really not, so you could please that person. But then at some point in time, the true you's going to come out.
Exactly. And you end up creating a life filled with resentment.
Exactly.
Because you're setting certain expectations that you need to play along with that don't even represent who you really are.
So when you do a healing session, what exactly do you do?
Okay. So my healing sessions are an hour long.
Okay.
I have my clients lay on the table, and I literally tune into their energy, project energy, and I can use my body as an imprint of their energy. So how the energy is moving in their body, I can literally feel it. So I like you feel that blocking your throat, let it go, so I can guide them to let go. So I tune in with their energy, and we become one, and I can feel the energy moving. So my goal is just to project. The energy has an intelligence of its own. So when I project, the energy will go straight to the blockage. It'll go here. I just follow it. Goes to a certain area and sticks in that area, and I move the energy and amplify it in that area. And then once that opens up, it'll move somewhere else, and I just follow it.
Wow.
So it's like a co-creation. I'm a vessel for it. So I just let it come in, and I co-create with it.
So what creates the blockage in the people?
Holding on to things from the past.
Okay.
To things that we don't release.
Okay.
There's been plenty of times clients start busting crying.
Mm-hmm.
On the table, and they'll say at the end, I thought I let that go. Like you said, I thought I let this go. It happened like 20 years ago.
That was me.
Sometimes trauma is so deep in your subconscious that you don't realize that you're running this program on autopilot, and it's really influencing a lot of decisions that you make in your life, and you don't even realize. So this is why when I do the self-mastery coaching, we work on three different levels. We work on the mental plane, which is the mental plane is the conscious plane. So the mental plane, you choose to engage in religion. You choose to engage in these activities. Mm-hmm. You're consciously choosing belief systems.
Right.
Well, on that level, when I work with my clients, there may be some belief systems that are not serving you, that's limiting you. So mm-hmm. I break down, see this belief system right here?
Mm-hmm.
It's limiting you, and this is how, and this is why you need to have a broader perspective and let that go.
Okay.
So that's the one level. Second level is the subconscious mind.
Mm-hmm.
But the subconscious mind is different because these are patterns that you're running on autopilot and you don't realize it. It's just running manually.
Mm-hmm.
These things based on deep trauma that you have within yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I can pinpoint those too. And I'll pull that up and uproot it and mm-hmm. say, well, see this right here? This is deep in your subconscious.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the difference between working with the conscious mind and the subconscious is this. Your conscious mind, I can tell you, you need to let this belief system go. Just stop engaging in that way.
Right.
Subconscious mind is different because the subconscious mind only comprehends symbolism.
Okay.
So therefore, if I find a block in your subconscious mind, I'll have you take part in a certain action
mm-hmm.
to speak to your subconscious mind. I'll give you an example. I had a client in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
She had trouble letting go of her ex-husband. And I said, okay, get a Chinese lantern, write his name on a sticky note, stick it on a Chinese lantern, and go outside and let it go and watch until you can't see it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
The symbolism of seeing him go and letting him go, you did an action to let him go, in a sense. It symbolized let him go.
Mm-hmm.
That speaks directly to your subconscious mind, and your subconscious mind, oh, let him go. That's how the subconscious mind works.
Right.
So this is why you have to take a certain symbolic action to deprogram or reprogram the subconscious mind. So that's the second level.
Mm-hmm.
The third level is the energy level. So when you have blockages in the mental plane,
mm-hmm.
in the conscious and the unconscious plane, it shows up physically in your aura, in your energetic aura,
mm-hmm.
reflections of it.
Okay.
So when I do the energy healing, I help clear that out. Clear mm-hmm. out the blockages that are reflections of the blockages from the mental, the conscious,
mm-hmm.
and the unconscious planes within yourself.
Wow. Okay. Because, like you said, like I told you, when I did it, you know, I felt like I had lost like 20 pounds because like that was like 20 years ago. And for me, and not to even know that I was still holding on to that for 20 years, it's crazy. But then it just really changed the whole outlook. And I think, and then that too, it allowed me to, my energy levels to go up.
Exactly. So let me speak on that real quick. I want to break it down on an energetic level. So, let's say, okay, so that happened to you 20 years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what happens is your soul, your energy, the energy of your soul becomes fragmented. So because you didn't let that go, what happens is a piece of your soul is literally trapped in time. So for example, I'll give you an example of what I mean by that. When you get triggered, so if a woman says something that triggers how that woman treated you
mm-hmm.
by accusing you of sexual harassment, you will respond from the same mind state that you were at the age when that happened. Because part of your energy is literally trapped in time. But when you let it go, that cycle pops and that energy comes forth into the present. And that's why you have more energy. So think about this.
Mm-hmm.
You may have 5 traumatic events of your soul that's fragmented in time, pieces of your energy that's trapped in the past. When you heal all those pieces of yourself, that's pieces of your energy that comes into your now. And you feel lighter and you feel more expansive and you feel better
mm-hmm.
because more of you is present.
Right.
You know, whenever we get triggered about something that happened in the past, we react from the same mental state we were in when that happened. So a lot of times, if you truly pay attention to the next time an adult gets mad or gets triggered about something.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be like, why are they so mad? It may be something in your mind, it may look like it's nothing. Pay attention to their attitude and how to react. I guarantee you, in most cases, they will act like a younger person. You will see mm-hmm. them acting out.
Okay.
A younger version of themselves, because part of them is still trapped.
Wow, that's crazy. Because it's not got me thinking. When I did get triggered, I did go to my old self.
Exactly.
I did go to my old self because I was using language that I really don't use now.
Exactly. Your fragmented self shows up, and your fragmented self is actually speaking from that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And a piece of you was stuck. So as soon as you chose to let that go, it came into the present. And that's why you felt lighter.
Right.
And it's, you know why you felt heavy? Think of it like this. Think about the energy that was in the past that you didn't let go of. Mm-hmm. Imagine that like an energetic weight, and you're trying to walk forward, but this weight is holding you back. That's why you felt so heavy.
Mm-hmm.
It's the weight of the trauma that you're still holding on to. Every time you let one of those weights go, you start moving faster ahead.
Right. Okay. That's good. I like that. So, how many sessions do you recommend people to have for you to do that?
Well, the self-mastery coaching program is a 3-month program.
Okay.
You know, because it's a lot of reprogramming, mm-hmm. subconscious and the conscious mind. It's a lot of work. And I'm going through, I'm taking notes, and I will give you activities and exercises for you to apply in real life and real time to shift things in your life, and you will see results.
Right.
So that's a 3-month, I do 3-month intervals like that.
Okay.
You know, so in most cases, clients don't need to go another 3 months because they learn so much within that space,
mm-hmm.
that they can take those tools and continually apply them in life.
Okay.
There's only been one time where I was going to suggest to the client go through another 3-month cycle, but she said, I think I need to go through a 3-month cycle before I even said it. She knew.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as far as the energy healing, mm-hmm. itself, just the energy healing, it's kind of like when you go to the masseuse, you know, you twisted your muscle,
mm-hmm.
you go get a massage. But the energy healing is like you're feeling kind of crappy, right?
Right.
So you come and get an energy healing, and I pull stuff up to pull some stuff out to make you feel better.
Right.
But it doesn't necessarily deal with the root. Sometimes I could clear a root, but see, if you don't deal with the conscious or the subconscious reason why the block was there in the first place,
right.
something will come right back and fill it on in.
Okay.
So this is why it's very important to not only just get energy healing, which is a relief,
mm-hmm.
it can make you feel better and clear things, but you really want to get to the root of why the blockage was there in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the self-mastery coaching comes in.
Okay. Okay. So, I don't know where to go with you, though, because it's so much, you know, it's so much going on. And I'm all into this because, you know, I've seen the difference in me and how I've been attracting different things into my life, you know, since I've let go of all that. When it comes down to relationships, because I want to go back to that, because I think most people really want a relationship and they really want to be in love and be loved, men and women. And it's funny because I had a client and she said one of the things she want to do spiritually is be spiritually connected to a guy that, you know, she could be like soulmates and life partners, all that kind of stuff. She said, but you know, some of the guys that she's been dealing with lately, that she's encountered lately, has not been the best. So I said, you know that you chose these men. So I said, what was it about these men that attracted you to them? Or was it, what was in your thought process about men that made you choose those men? She didn't want to hear that.
Mm-hmm. Because most of the time we want to blame other people. We don't want to take responsibility for our choices.
Right.
And me personally, look, I'm thankful for all of my relationships, whether they're good, bad, or however you want to label them, because at the end of the day, I've learned lessons within them and I've grew
within
them. So
yeah.
I'm thankful for all of the lessons, all of the pain I experienced, because I've always chose to be a student of pain instead of being a victim of circumstances. So if I'm hurting, if someone hurts my feelings or I feel pain in a situation, the first thing I do is ask the question, why am I in pain right now?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that that person did, why is it that I feel so much pain because that person said that about me or did that to me?
Right.
And if I go inside myself, I can peel back and find something that's been triggered within me related to a trauma that I experienced
in
the past.
Right.
So the more layers that I shed and shed, the less I get triggered, the less I get triggered. So now I don't get triggered as much about anything because I shed so much.
Yeah. But the work that you do on yourself and the work I do on myself, you know, it's like common knowledge for us now to do it. But for people listening in, it might be painful for them. And I think a lot of people are afraid to do. They want to go to the next level of who they are, but they don't really, a lot of them don't really want to do the work that needs to be done.
And you know why? Because the work that needs to be done hurts.
Yep.
And I'm going to tell you this. this simple thing right here, the simple different perspective of looking at pain, changed my life. I decided to call pain my friend.
Mm-hmm.
When I did that, it shifted everything. And I'm going to tell you why. If it wasn't for pain, you wouldn't know you had a wound. Just think about if you got your arm cut, you went across something, you didn't feel it, and you bled out and didn't feel any pain, you would die.
Mm-hmm.
The pain is just a signal to let you know something is wrong.
Right.
It's not only like that on a physical level, it's like that on an emotional level too.
Yeah.
So if you're feeling pain, that means there's a wound that needs to be attended to. It doesn't mean fight everybody who made me feel pain. It means stop, there's a wound.
Right.
So this is how I react. There's a wound.
Right.
Where am I bleeding inside?
Mm-hmm.
I need to go patch that up or fix that. What can I do to fix it? And that's when you do the self-mastery. And that's those are the tools that I give my clients. When you feel the pain, how do you deal with it?
Right.
It depends on what the pain is.
Right.
You know, I have certain tools that I can apply that work on certain things, but certain things are self, you know, or just for you,
mm-hmm.
in the moment, because my work is very intuitive.
Right.
I never know what I'm going to say.
Right.
In the moment, it comes to me.
Exactly.
I'll just listen to a client and, you know, it'll just come on. This.
Right.
This.
I agree.
You know, there's been times where a client will be telling me something and literally I'll say, okay, you need to soak with this type of salt in the bath. And then I'll look it up online,
mm-hmm.
and it'll be connected directly to a certain issue that they have with their body.
And mm-hmm.
It's like downloads.
Yeah.
So I just trust myself, and I'm a vessel. I let it come in from my client, and I'm open with my heart, and I just allow.
Yep.
And it all comes through.
Yep. You know, it's funny you said that. That's probably why you are successful at what you do. A guy told me that the reason why people like yourself and myself are going to be so great, we know we both are on our way there, is that we genuinely care. And, you know, there's a lot of people who are coaches who see people as opportunity to make money. And so a lot of times they don't really tell them what they need to know. They talking about bits and pieces. Exactly. So they can keep coming back.
Exactly.
You know,
I don't do that
either. You know, you may not like the fact what I'm going to tell you, but, you know, it's, you know, especially with relationships, I think a lot of these relationship coaches sometimes don't tell the whole deal because they want them to keep coming back. But, you know, because I think a lot.
Or they'll say, you guys can make it work knowing that they're not even a good match.
Right.
But come back, we can make it work knowing that.
Right.
But just comes
from or knowing, especially, or they'll know this, you know, knowing that the female really wants you to say, it's that man's fault. And make them feel better. You know, and the men have to own their stuff. But as a coach, you know, it's your responsibility to say, you know, where you at. You know, all aspects of your life begins and ends with you, not Joe Blow or whoever else. And a lot of us don't want to hear that. And so it's good to see people like you who are very authentic and very genuine, who wants to see people be the best version of themselves. And, you know, it's hard sometimes because, you know, people want the easy way out.
Friend showed me a lot.
Yeah.
See, so when that pain is coming up, it's letting you know, Jason, something is wrong. Isn't that what a friend's supposed to do?
Mm-hmm.
A friend lets you know when something is wrong when you don't see it.
Right.
That's what pain does. So why do we demonize pain? We demonize it because we don't like the way it feels.
Mm-hmm.
But why is it? Why don't we demonize physical pain? We don't think about this for a second.
Right.
Physical pain, we do not demonize.
Right.
We just know, oh, it's a wound that take time to heal. It's the same thing with emotional pain.
Mm-hmm.
We need to look at emotional pain the same way we look at physical pain. Know that it needs time to heal and give it the time that it needs.
Mm-hmm.
Be patient with it just like we're patient with the physical aspect of wounds.
So, question. Do you think it's ever a possibility we could get men in a facility and have a conversation and create the heart space, like you and I will say, to make them feel comfortable, that they will Express.
I actually started a circle called the Atlanta Brotherhood Circle early last year.
Okay.
It only lasted maybe 6 months. And it was beautiful. It was a space. I'm talking about it was straight men, gay men, black, Hispanic, white. We were all in there. And I wanted to create a space to where we can get things off of our chest.
Mm-hmm.
I saw men break down and cry and didn't feel ashamed about sharing their pain. It was that type of circle. It was beautiful. But at the end of the day, they really didn't want it. So I don't, you know, but I will say, on a positive note,
mm-hmm.
I'm starting to get more male clients than ever before. Before, it was only like female clients.
Right.
People thought that I only work with women, which is not the case.
Right.
You know, but surprisingly enough, more men are starting to come now. So I think it's just a gradual process, you know. I'm hoping, because I have so many female clients say, Jason, we're in the men. So I've been trying
women
to do the work. Because a lot of these women are doing the work.
Yeah.
You know, not so many. But, you know, it's the whole concept of hyper-masculine culture that has defined us as men.
Yeah.
That makes us afraid to step more into our more balanced way of being and embracing the feminine. So I understand the reasons why. And that's why I use myself as a projection of that you can be a man and still feel.
And that's been my intention. You know, when I have people on the show, so I've been having a lot of men on the show who are either someone like yourself or someone who's into empathy, you know, an empathy coach, or, you know, into truth, love, and compassion, those type of things. And these are like athletes. They were athletes at one time, and they were real men, but they are in tune with both sides. And that's been my whole intention, because I know it's part of the problem that, you know, when we think of certain things, we always think that only gay guys do that, and that's not true. And we gotta stop creating that story to prevent ourselves from being the best version of who we could be.
Right, and I also think that us as men, what we need to do is when we see a friend of ours showing interest in something creative that's outside of sports,
right,
support that. Like, don't shoot him down for that.
Right.
Because he could be bringing a gift to the world that could change the world,
mm-hmm.
but we shoot each other down.
Right.
Because we want to put each other in these boxes, in these man boxes. So it's time to, you know, step out of that 2017.
Right.
And grow and allow ourselves enough room to evolve, you know?
Right. So how do you attract the clients you get? Because you get clients all over the world. So how did you get to that point?
I've been doing this for about 7 years. I've had a heavy presence on social media,
mm-hmm.
just sharing content. I've been consistent for 7 years.
Okay.
And I knew that I needed to stay consistent by sharing my views, sharing my articles, sharing my videos. I have tons of videos on my YouTube, tons of information. And I knew that over time, people would see in my consistency. And not only my consistency, but my evolution as a coach and the energy healer. People have seen my evolution. They've seen me become more humble and more strong in my stance and more gentle, but strong at the same time. You know, so that authentic natural progression and people being able to see it consistently really helps as well.
Okay.
So I want to say that, you know, whatever it is you want to do, be consistent. Because I could have stopped a long time ago, not making enough money.
Right.
But I can't stop. There's a fire in me that's burning.
Right.
So bright.
Yeah.
Even if I said tomorrow I'm going to stop, in a few days I'll be right back at it.
Right.
Because it's a fire.
Right.
Everlasting, infinite fire that's burning in me so much that I couldn't put it out if I tried.
So what made you move to California before you came back here?
Okay, so connected, and she invited me out, and so I was doing the healing and stuff out there. It really didn't work out. The flow wasn't flowing right out in California either.
Really?
Redondo Beach. Yeah, man. It was, the energy was flat. So that's the thing about me too. I'm very sensitive to energy.
Mm-hmm.
So literally, some areas are literally flat. So when I go in the city, I can feel the energy of the city.
Mm-hmm.
Like Las Vegas feels flat to me.
Mm-hmm.
There's no movement.
Okay.
That's how Redondo Beach feels. It's just flat.
Okay.
So Atlanta has energy.
Mm-hmm.
The energy in Atlanta is vibrant.
Okay.
It's moving. You know. Okay. It's shaking things up. Things are getting shooken all around.
Okay.
It's starting to, like, the energy is changing, but in a good way, but it's still moving.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I've been called back to the ATL, so I go where the flow leads me.
Okay. You kind of help me out with something, because, you know, I'm like you. I'm very spirit driven, and the spirit had been kind of like, to nudge me to make a move, and I have been leaning towards California. But then again, it's like the story that we create is that, you know, sometimes you could create the story that Atlanta might not be ready for what we do. So you might want to go to an area that's more in line with what you do.
That was kind of how I felt when I was going to Cali too.
Uh-huh.
It's very interesting you said that. And I'm not going to lie, I kind of felt like that last year in a sense about Atlanta. But then something shifted.
Uh-huh.
Like around in the fall, the energy shifted in Atlanta. I felt it. I was like, oh, hold on. Something is, that's why I say there's a lot of shaking up going on to
right.
Where certain people are getting shook and out of positions.
Uh-huh.
It's like some rearranging going on.
Okay.
So now I'm like, oh, now I can see. So I can, and this is another thing I teach my clients how to do. I literally know how to read the energetic code of what's going on. I can follow the energy and fill it out. Oh,
mm-hmm.
Now it's time. Or, you know.
Right.
So there's something developing in Atlanta right now. Something swelling underneath Atlanta that's coming up.
Okay.
My friend Narendra says from the dirt. She always said that. Something mm-hmm. coming up from the dirt.
Okay.
Many people probably can't feel it, but I can.
Okay.
And I know my part in this now. I'm kind of clear about how I'm going to be involved with it.
Right.
See certain things lining up, and it's exciting.
Right.
So I feel like Atlanta is about to explode. I feel like it's going to be a new renaissance here that involves uh-huh. music. I mean, music is already exploding in Atlanta, but I mean a more spiritual-based explosion.
Okay.
Inside out.
Okay.
I feel like that's what's bubbling in Atlanta right now.
Okay. Yeah, he knows. You know, because somebody said to me, you know, and they didn't say it from a selfish perspective. They just felt that that I was needed here. And it's a lot that, you know, that I do as a holistic coach and a life coach that is needed here. And just to be patient with it, because, like you said, they feel a shift. And they need more people like ourselves to be here when that shift changes, to really help them to really grow. I do see people, you know, really kind of change, but sometimes you feel like you want to be in the midst of where all the action is at.
See it in your mind a certain way of how you think it should go, but you mm-hmm. have to surrender.
Yep.
And let it develop.
Because patience.
I'll give you an example, because things are developing right now in a way that I expected to develop in a different. I saw it in my mind a different way, and I'm seeing it develop this way. I'm like, oh, that's how it's
right. going
to come forward.
Right.
You know, and I'm just allowing it to do.
Yep.
You know, so with that being said, I'm doing. I want to. Shout out to my partner Catherine Aduni.
We're doing
some things together.
We're I was gonna bring that up.
Gang conversations. We're doing our first event Saturday, January 21st.
Yep.
At Kendall Park Yoga, and we get down to the root of relationship issues, and we give you tools, no filter.
Mm-hmm.
You can ask.
I saw that.
We will share our lives and our situations with you, and it's real and raw. It's no sugarcoating anything.
Okay.
Catherine is one of the realest people I know. So we want to use that platform as a way to speak about the elephant in the rooms within relationships. Because I'm tired of people not addressing the root. I see a lot of, if you want to get a man, you need to do like this. Or if you want to get a woman, you need to do like this. No.
Yep.
What you need to do is find the roots within you and uproot them.
Absolutely.
So you can attract a more healthier relationship. But it's you working on you.
You.
It's not changing or pretending so you can attract some. No.
Exactly.
That's fake. That's not real.
Exactly. Can you say that one more time, please?
That's fake. It's not real. If you want an authentic relationship, you need to start being authentic. So enough with this, not addressing the elephants in the room. Some of the things that may come up may be painful, but we will go straight all the way to the root, because that's what's needed.
Right.
You don't see many people getting down to the nitty gritty.
And this they
is
don't.
What Catherine is about. We're serious and we will see you and see the root and talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to ask a question that you really don't want the answer for, don't ask it.
I agree with that. I agree with that because you're not, you, to me, a lot of times the questions they ask, they really want you to be on their side.
Exactly. And I'm not biased. And
right.
See, and a lot of times I worked with a couple before.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, me and Catherine worked with a couple. And you can tell that the woman was trying to get her to side. And Catherine is not biased because you're a woman. And then the dude, I'm not biased because you're a man. I don't play like that.
Right.
I'm not biased because we got the same skin color. I'm not biased because we're the same gender. I'm not biased because we grew up in the same neighborhood.
Right.
I speak the truth. Whatever it is,
right.
I'm going to speak that.
Right.
So it don't matter who you are, what you look like, or none of that.
Right.
I don't even bring that to the table.
Right.
You know, so we want to get real. If we truly, truly want to be better, we got to get real.
Right.
That's it.
Right, because, you know, we go, you know, when I talk to my friends and they talk about, you know, the 60% of all the women are going, you know, black women going to be never get married, and you know the different ratios to women to men based on the city. My thing is, what does that have to do with you?
Exactly. Exactly.
And they don't want to hear that.
Right, because you know we want to point outward. We don't want to say, "Well, I'm not attracting a good partner. Why?"
Is that
what is it within me?
Exactly.
Bringing this dysfunctional men my way or these dysfunctional women my way? See, we don't take responsibility to go in and look
right.
at the mirror.
Right.
And I still do that with myself.
I have to.
Still do this.
You know, when you go through a journey and like, you know, especially people that God is going to use in a positive way, like yourself and myself, you know, He really. For everybody, He really wants you to do the work on you, and He's gonna show you some things that you really just do not want to deal with, or you just didn't see coming. And so, in this journey with me, you know, I have learned some things about myself that I had to change. And you know, I was that dude. I'm, you know, very family oriented, but at the end of the day, I never allowed them to earn a spot in my space. If you know, if that makes any sense to you, I just gave them the spot, but they never really earned the spot.
Right.
And so, I did all the work. I did all the work. You know, I did. You know, if I'm coming home, I do. I create. You know, this is what we're gonna do. And so, when I finally started stepping back and started saying, okay, if I don't do this, what's gonna happen? It don't get done. So I'm like, so it tells me, okay, you did too much. You not allow them to create the relationship with you. So when you start to create change, most people don't like change. Because then you change, when you create a new normal, that old normal benefited them because they have to do no work. So now I'm saying, okay, it's going to be something different. I'm not going to call y'all and say I'm coming home. You know, I'm not going to create no outing for us to do. Y'all tell me what y'all want.
Scatter.
Yep.
And this is what I tell my clients. When you work with me, prepare to lose friends. Because
Yep. Think
about this. All the friends of your circle in your circle right now reflect
who you
similar
are.
Trauma.
Yep.
As soon as you heal a part of your trauma, one or two things are going to happen. You bring all of your friends in your circle to a fork in the road. Either they're going to ask you, what are you doing? You're different. You seem more at peace. Or they're going to leave because you will no longer reflect the comfortable reflection of their trauma.
Mm-hmm.
And they want the comfort of seeing their trauma reflected. So they will go and hang in other circles that has the same trauma that they can see reflected so they feel comfortable. But the ones in your circle who want to grow because they've seen you grow, they're going to ask you, and you give them tools, and then they grow.
Right. That I agree. Because through all that, it's been the same crew that, you know, has grown. We have grown together. Family-wise, like you said, you know, they all run away because, you know, I no longer do a lot of stuff that we all had in common. Life for all of us, a lot of us had in common was liquor. We all loved to drink and party. So now I've toned that down. Yeah, because I'm not fun no more.
And you know what? That's one of the hard things to deal with for clients when they go through my self-mastery coaching program, because when you change, you may have to. And the thing is, they will just fall away, and it's hard as you're increasing, you're evolving, and the people that you were with for so long are not coming with you. Mm-hmm. It could be tough to deal with at first.
Yeah.
But after a while, you kind of get used to it, because I evolve and change so much that when people fall off, I already know
them. Right.
I can feel. I just let it fall off and just keep. Because I'm not going to stop evolving for anybody.
Right.
I don't care who you are.
Right.
Because I understand my evolution is benefiting me, and I am being a better representation of God or Source, whatever you want to call it, the more I allow myself to evolve, because the more I evolve, the more clear vessel I am for God to come through me to do what God needs to do through me.
Right. I agree. And because, and then what I've learned is that I don't change. So whoever I am here in Atlanta, when I go home to Cleveland, that's who I am in Cleveland. I'm not going to try to revert back to my old self to make everybody comfortable. You know, I need to be comfortable with who the version of who I am at this moment, and not me feel the need to make you guys feel comfortable. So I'm going to go back to being that party guy and doing all that. No, I'm not going to do that. So
right, you have to honor yourself.
Yeah.
And this is what I tell people. You have to honor yourself first so you can be the best version of yourself, so you can represent yourself in the best way and be of service in the best way you can be of service. That's what we're here to do. We're here to be of service in our best way, whatever that is.
Right.
Everybody has a different lane.
Right.
My lane is doing what I'm doing. Your lane is doing what you're doing.
Right.
Someone's lane may be a child carer to take care of children. Everything has value.
Mm-hmm.
In the system, but we have to reckon, and that's another issue with this culture.
Mm-hmm.
We don't value the things that are important, like, for example, people to take care of children. That's a very important part of the puzzle,
right.
But yet we don't value that
right.
in culture.
Right.
So therefore, the people who are caretakers, they don't feel good about what they're doing. They may try to strive to do something else because they feel like, well, I'm just a caretaker of children.
Right.
But we need you to be a if you're a good at taking care of kids, we need you to do that.
Right.
And I think our value is misplaced, and I don't think we give enough appreciation to all of the pieces of the puzzle. We only give appreciation to the athletes, celebrities,
yep.
But the construction workers, what about the teachers?
Mm-hmm.
All of these pieces of the puzzle are valuable, and I honor all of them.
Right.
I don't treat a celebrity better than I would treat a teacher. I treat them all the same because I understand it's all a puzzle.
All a puzzle.
And every piece of the puzzle makes the picture, right? But when we don't honor the pieces of the pieces of the puzzle don't fit right and the picture is not clear.
Right.
So if we want a clearer picture, we have to honor the pieces of all of the puzzle.
Right. And I think we have a problem allowing people to have their own opinion. If you have an opinion that's outside of what they feel a black person should believe,
attacked,
then they attack you.
You're a coon.
Yep. Yep.
Uncle Tom. Right, and you know, we about to really go deep now.
Because before I let you go deep, because I feel that's blatant disrespect.
Yeah, definitely.
I feel that's blatant disrespect. Who gives you the right to call somebody out their name? Because they weren't born Uncle Tom. They weren't born Coon. They were born with a name. So who gives you the right to call them anything out of their name because you don't agree with their thought pattern or how they live their life? I don't understand, because if somebody calls you out, you know, your name, let alone if they called you the N-word, all hell's going to break loose.
Right.
But you could justify your bad behavior because they're one of us and they're not acting like.
It's hypocritical.
Yeah.
You know what? And one of the reasons why a culture doesn't evolve is because of the mob mentality. Not allowing a broader perspective to be heard or even considered, it keeps a culture stagnant. Yep. And when a culture is stagnant, a culture suffers greatly.
Mm-hmm.
All root of suffering can be linked back to stagnation. And what causes stagnation? A blockage.
Mm-hmm.
So when the mob mentality stops the evolution of thought and quiets it and kills it,
mm-hmm.
it's actually killing itself as a collective to grow.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why I am open to the younger generation coming up and challenging traditions,
mm-hmm.
challenging belief systems, because at the end of the day, the new generation is coming up to help us evolve if we give them a space
to
and allow them to do it. But see, we so caught up in traditions. No, you need to do it like this.
Yeah.
Why? If this young man or woman has a better way to do it, let them evolve the culture.
Yeah.
Man. Give them the space to evolve. And it's so sad that, you know, if you want to talk about black culture, the coon thing, we can be so critical of other races outside ourselves, but constructive criticism of each other, we automatically get attacked if I break something down clearly.
Mm-hmm.
You a coon. You know, why is that? We have to allow ourselves to be critical of ourselves if we want to evolve.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So, and that's not only, because you can look at different layers. You got black culture, American culture. You can go all go all the way out. So same thing with American culture. Just looking at American culture. If we don't allow ourselves to question American culture and speak up about certain things that we see to change it and get attacked, you're not patriotic. See, it's on that level, the same thing pops up.
Right.
You know, you're not patriotic.
Right.
Or you're cool. So it's, we have been so indoctrinated with this self-destructive mind state that we just naturally keep each other in check so we don't evolve.
Right.
So, but I'm a rebel though, so I'll speak up.
I agree. We have a call coming in.
Okay.
How you doing? Who's Hello?
Yes, is this Kevin Thorne?
It is.
Hey man, how you doing, man? This is Larry Boy Hodges from Beer in the Conversation. How you doing,
Larry? I'm good, brother. How you doing?
Doing great, man. Happy New Year to you. Good to see that you're doing good things. Salutations to your guest.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Peace.
Happy New Year to him as well.
Happy New Year.
And I didn't want to interrupt
because
I was on a roll, but I heard something and I just felt the need to comment on it.
Okay.
A lot of meaty stuff y'all were talking about there. I would like to say this. I agree 100% with the brother said, and I think that he touched a little bit on construction workers, caretakers. Listen, here's the thing. A lot of times that as individuals, we get discouraged whenever it is that we have a calling or a gift or a natural inclination to do something, which can be all just individually or collectively all in one. And we don't understand that it is a God that put that thing in us.
Mm-hmm.
And so the discouragement a lot of times comes from, how the hell am I going to make any money doing this? Okay? And whether it's taking care of children or no matter what it is. I had a man tell me at 16 years old that I would make $1 million if I chose to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I think that one of the things that is key to, I didn't take that path, but I think that one of the things key for people to recognize is that your gift will make a way for you in life.
I agree.
And we need to stop trying to get into professions because we're driven by money and get into things that we're purpose-driven for because it's going to make a way for us no matter what it is. I met a guy, who has a living for being a voice impersonator for Kermit the Frog.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And so all I'm saying is that there are so many different talents of people, and we have, our society has, they've been very, for the most part, victorious in what they've done and forcing us, especially as black men,
mm-hmm.
and striving for being athletes or entertainers.
Yep.
When we start talking about the on the criminal, you know what I'm saying, on the illegal side, dope boy. So
right.
We all have talents within us, and I just kind of want to piggyback off what the brother said. I don't want to take too much time, but I just wanted to add that what it is that that we have in us, no matter what it is, whether it's teaching or whatever your talent may be, if it's coaching, if it's being in law enforcement, if it's being a heating and air guy, if it's in being a barber, not only is your natural talent going to take care of you financially, and that's a promise that God made to us when you start looking at the talents that he gave individuals, but additionally, your ministry in life is tied to your talent. The pathway that you're supposed to take helps to, you're going to be in a position to minister to people no matter what it is that you do.
Right.
I agree.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I agree, and I think because that's why you and I both have radio shows, because the radio show is my ministry. It allows me to teach people another way of thinking and seeing things. And you know, when I decided to do this, when I decided to do this, when it was placed on me to do this, you know, I vowed to be 100% unapologetic on what I do and how I do things. You know, I know a lot of the stuff I talk about is unconventional to most people, but it's something that needs to be taught so you can see things differently.
Absolutely.
Right. And so, and same with what he does on his show. You know, it's time to stop sugarcoating everything and sit down and just tell the truth.
Right. And I wanna add on to what you were saying, brother, about following your purpose instead of the pay. Also, what I want people to realize is this. We give up too quick. We live in a microwave society, so you may feel like you have a gift and you'll try to do it for 2 or 3 years and you just stop. Well, I guess it's not working. No, if you really did the knowledge and really studied successful businessmen and women, what you would find is in most cases it probably took between 5 and 8 years before it really took off.
Right.
But they stuck to their guns and they kept going. Like I said earlier, consistency.
Right.
Because I'm real close to doing bigger things, but I've been consistent because I'm not doing this just for a paycheck. I'm doing this because it's me.
Right.
This is who I am. So I can't be anything other than who I am. So the thing is, I want to let people know that you have to keep going. Don't stop after 3 years. Don't stop after 5 years. But here's the thing. You have to be honest with yourself, though. Whatever it is that you're trying to build on yourself independently, is it truly who you are?
Right.
Because if it's not, you need to stop altogether. But if it's who you are, if it comes so natural to you that it's second nature, that's it.
Right.
Stick to it for 7 years, for 8 years. And I promise you, eventually, your consistency will bring you to that space open up like the ocean.
And I'll give everybody an example. You know, those who know me know, you know, I'm a fitness instructor as well as a life coach and health coach. So I put a lot of my time and energy teaching spin classes. And, you know, with the soul cycles and the flywheels of the world, that those places can allow you to make good money, six figures. And I was pursuing those things. And I would never get I know I'm good, but I would never make the audition or whatever. So a young lady came to me, and she lives in Smyrna, and she drove all the way down to Buckhead to take my class because she knew after class we're going to have a conversation. And she said, in that conversation, spin classes is not where you're supposed to be going. It's a platform that he wants you to use to help people be the best version of themselves, but it's not what you're supposed to be doing. She said, your gift and talent is coaching. And once you accept that and stay in that lane, you're going to see things change. And just like that, everything changed.
And you know what's interesting?
Right.
I can read people's energy and I can see behind the veil of people. And there are a lot of people who have these high paying jobs and they try to act like that they're, But when they're home alone, they're miserable because they're not doing what they love. And right. they hate going to work. But they're making good money. They drive in a fancy car.
Right.
So me personally, I would rather be comfortable doing what I love to do than to be rich doing what I hate to do. Right. Because in that case, I'm not honoring myself.
And see, I think the part that people don't understand, money don't make happiness.
Exactly.
And so when I transfer from corporate to this, and I'm not making as much money as I did in corporate as I am making right now at this moment, people don't understand. They say, how can you be happier making less when you did making all that money? But all that money, I wouldn't be who I was.
Now let's talk. I want to break that down. I want to break that down real quick. If you pay attention to the people in your life, and I guarantee you will see this, and this is the energetic code pattern reading that I do, that I teach my clients how to do. So I'm going to give you an example of this. Everybody in your life who seems to be more at peace will have less.
Mm-hmm.
The people who are suffering the most have more.
Right.
That's how you can weigh and see. If you go in someone's house and they got a whole bunch of stuff all over the place, I guarantee you they're suffering. If you go into someone's house and it feels open,
mm-hmm.
because here's the thing. Remember I told you about the fragmented pieces of yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Get this. The more fragmented pieces of yourself you have trapped in time, the more you're trying to fill in your physical space to fill in that void. But as soon as you bring those pieces of yourself to the present, now you got more of yourself present, and your more expansive self needs more space to be in. And that's why you start getting rid of things.
And I tell you, brother, I would love to piggyback off of that. Now, you kind of went where I wanted to go, and I know this is y'all's show.
Come on.
But what I can say for sure is that the more you have tangibly, the more maintenance.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And a lot of times the more fixed debt that you have, you know. And so when you begin operating your purpose, see, here's the thing. I mean, God put something in us deliberately so that we would not have peace until we begin to operate within our purpose.
Right.
But that's a good thing,
mm-hmm.
because it's something that will drive us to our purpose. Because here's the thing, the gift that you have, Kevin Thornton, and you, sir, the guest of the show, and even myself, our gift is the way God's system of reciprocity is set up. Our gift is not even for us, it's for other people.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so we will not, our destiny and everybody else's destiny to it in some part around us is tied to us operating in our gift.
Right.
And so we can make tons of money. And we can fill that up with, and let's be honest with you, you know, because I've made some good money. I'm sure you brothers have too. We can fill it up with automobiles. We can fill it up with homes and vacations and all types of women and all types of lavish sex and alcohol and drugs. But at the end of the day, the void is still there.
Exactly.
And so when you spoke about earlier about not having faith in it, you do have to have faith in what you're doing. Know what you're doing. A good doctor. Or a good, whatever it is that you do, if you have a passion for it, you would do it for free. You would do it for no money.
Exactly. And that's how you know it's right, when you enjoy it.
Exactly. And so, I mean, Noah, and I mean, I hate to go back to Bible days, but if you believe in the Bible, Noah preached for 120 years. He didn't live to be 120. He was older than 120 years old. And per se, based off Bible, but preached for 120 years about something coming. Bill, no, I mean, and I mean, I don't even think that we have one iota of the exponential faith that quote unquote individuals had back then. But what is 7 or 8 years? Because most people, like you said, they're miserable. They're working 8 hours a day. And I would venture that they're not actually working for 8 hours. They're unhappy for 5 and maybe doing 3 hours worth of work with somebody breathing down their neck. They're commuting cumulatively 3 to 4 hours a day, an hour and a half to 2 hours each way in traffic, mm-hmm. to get home where the kids are not eating healthy because they're feeding them fast food. That the whole our whole family structure is destroying itself behind people who are not making enough money to pay their bills, and they're unhappy every day of their life. And so I said to one of my co-hosts, I said, listen, I said, shit, we'd be better off suited getting a man and woman together and going to get a $600 two-bedroom apartment off Candler Road somewhere, and this is no diss to anybody who lives off Candler Road, but she said, well, you know, the neighborhoods aren't that good over there. I said, well, shit, I said, if we would get out of the debt, do our passion, and we move into a home where one man can work and afford and we raise a family, they would be great communities because there'd be nothing but people like us over there.
Now, you just took it where I was going to take it. That's exactly where I was going to take it. If we could realize that we can cut away some of the expenses by coming together, instead of being in this big six-bedroom house with two people in it, if we come together and share the resources, we can create time, because what we really lack is time to cultivate our gifts.
That's right.
We can create time, and then you have to work as much. Now you have more time to cultivate your gift, and you can slowly slide off of doing that job you don't like to do. Once you get a following, you present your gift, and it catches on. You know, but we have to stop being so segregated as far as, because we're in neighborhoods, we're not in communities anymore, and we need to bring the communities back. And that means coming back in, sharing homes, sharing resources, so therefore we can free up the time to cultivate the essence of who we truly are and present that and find fulfillment within which we present, and people are fulfilled from what we present. And then we get fulfillment from them being fulfilled from it.
I agree.
Absolutely.
I agree.
Absolutely. Well, and I didn't want to jump y'all, but just y'all was getting so meaty, I couldn't help it, Kevin. I am so sorry.
Man. No problems. No problem. I'm gonna call in your show tomorrow.
Please feel free to tell your brother in there to feel free to call in and listen in. But thank y'all, man. For
no problem.
Thank you.
Time out to hear my call, man. And,
appreciate
and
you.
God bless both of y'all. I know y'all will do Peace. Well. And as you know, Kevin, I'm here for you if you need me.
Appreciate it. Thank you, dog.
All right. Thank you.
All right.
Is it the other one waiting?
Okay. All right. So, wow. I don't know. I got to scale back a minute. Because you know, that was in-depth. But you go ahead. Let's talk.
Well, let's talk more about the purpose thing.
Yeah.
I mean, when I say your purpose, I mean, what is it to find your purpose? What is it that you talk about all the time when you're with your friends? What is that one mm-hmm. thing that you get excited about when you talk about it? That is the compass. Because here's the thing that I realized in my life from experience. Sometimes the thing that you're interested in that moment is not really the niche yet. It's right. just a magnet pulling you forward. So, for instance, I start off in the music industry. I used to be a producer, so mm-hmm. making beats and doing all this, producing records. So I followed that pull, and that's where my right. my joy was, my excitement was there. But right. eventually it pulled me into other things, and that fell off. And then I started working kind of like in the film industry, and then that kind of fell off, mm-hmm. and then I came into my coaching, what have you. Mm-hmm. But see, why did I have to go through the music and the film? Because now I'm using the skills that I developed from the music and the mm-hmm. film to create content for what I'm doing now.
Right.
Now I know how to mix sound for my videos.
Right.
Now I understand the cinematography of the videos and how to edit because I worked with a director.
Right.
So now I'm able to use those skills for the actual niche, which is this. Because
right.
this is where the fire is. This
right.
is where this is like the... Eventually, it'll snap in. That niche will just snap in. But whatever that passion is that's guiding you at this moment may not be the complete niche, but it's the mm-hmm. magnet pulling you. So just walk.
Right.
Walk.
It's all part of the journey because, you know,
yes.
like for me, you know, I know it's coaching, but then sometimes you make a left and you're like, okay, now I got this knowledge here, mm-hmm. so I'm supposed to do this. But then... a friend of mine just said, he was my spin class. He said, you know, I was telling him about you. We're going to do this, talk about this. He said, that's where your soul is at. You know, you are, your soul of who you are is into the whole energy, you know, coaching. But, you know, have to understand that energy is all about energy and being mindful. So the higher vibrations, he said, so you... He said, you got to be okay hanging with the people who look considered like hippies. Mm-hmm. He said, because that's really who you are. Mm. He said, you just a cleaned up version of it. You don't who just do exercise. But he said, the reality is you a hippie. Mm-hmm. You know, you really into the sage. You into the all that stuff that they all do. You just don't have the look. Right. And I said, he said, well, once you embrace that, it's going to take you to a whole nother level, because once you embrace that, you get in that community, then it's going to elevate you to different places, because now you would truly like-minded individuals.
And I want to say this, I want to piggyback off of what you just said. Once you find out what your niche is and you really step into it, whatever that niche is, it may look weird to your former friends and family members or what have you, and they may say, oh, you a hippie. Like my uncle, he'd be like, yeah, damn hippie.
Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, yep. But, you know, the thing is, you can't take yourself so seriously,
yeah,
and you can't care about how people see you. You just have to know that if this feels good and this is, yeah, who you are, you have to step confidently,
yep,
within that path,
yep,
and just be it. And if people just make fun of you, make fun of yourself along with them.
Yep.
Joke about it. It's funny.
Yep.
You call me a hippie, I laugh. Like, it's nothing. The thing is, at the end of the day, if you know who you are, be who you are.
Right. And I agree. And a friend of mine, who's actually going to start having a guest spot on the show probably in the next month or so. We been friends since middle school. So we went to middle school, junior high school, and college together. And so she know me better than most people. And so she said, you know, and she's a coach now too. And she said, you know, people like us and yourself, we got to be okay being different. You know, being, you know, once you are okay being different and, you know, just walk your path, then everything else comes along the way.
Right.
And she said, most people have a hard time accepting that they're different than everybody else. And that struggle keep them from being the best version of themselves and allowing the universe to fully use them in the way they need to be used.
Right.
And so I realized for me that I'm a servant leader. And so I'm here to serve. So it's not always about me, mm-hmm, you know. So, you know, once I understand that, you know, I know my gifts, like you said, our gifts is not for us. Our gifts is for them.
Right.
And once you understand that, you know, and you serve them to the best that you can, everything else come along the way.
And you know what? Your individual identity has to become more important than a collective identity.
Right.
And once you realize that, can stand alone and with the collective,
right?
Either or,
right?
You know, but if you allow the mob mentality to limit you, you will eventually be disappointed in your life,
mm-hmm,
because the people who are trying to hold you back are trying to hold you back because they're afraid to go forward,
right?
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 So you have to be courageous. There's going to be times you're going to cry. It's going to be disappointing. It's going to be pain. It's going to hurt. I saw Dame Dash talking about this. Dame Dash talks about this all the time. He said, if you want to be a boss, it's going to hurt.
You're going to go
through growing pain. But see, most people don't want to go through that, see that pain.
It's going to hurt.
It's going to hurt. So they think people like Dame Dash or Jay-Z, whoever it is, they think that just because they see them in a successful light at the end of the rainbow, they think that, yeah, I want to be like that. But no, you don't, because you don't want to go through that pain. You ain't ready, because you're going to go through so many ups and downs.
Yep.
I'm talking about mental breakdowns.
Yep.
I had nervous breakdowns. and I just keep it real. I just tell the truth. This is part of the process.
Yeah.
But as long as you understand that the phoenix can always rise.
Right. And yeah, because, you know, you're going to have those moments, and then you just learn. In this journey, I have learned not to have expectations no more of people.
Okay.
Because if you have expectations of people, then they can let you down.
True.
So I stopped having expectations.
Okay.
Because sometimes you get tired getting let down. You know what I'm saying?
And you expect people to move the way you move.
Yep.
This is one of the things I had to learn. Because I operate and walk a certain way with the integrity and my man of my word,
right,
I expect everybody else to. But then I'll be like, oh, then I keep forgetting.
Right.
Everybody don't think like me, or everybody don't move like me.
Right.
So now I just let it be what it is. So they don't, okay, their actions show me this, that, and I just keep it moving and do what I need to do. So I'm kind of like you. You know, I really, I just let people, I give people space to show me who they are.
Yep.
Put it that way. And mm-hmm. whatever shows up is what it is. I accept it and make decisions from there.
Right.
Period.
That's something I had to learn. And so I learned, okay, show me who you are, and I will deal with you accordingly based on that. And it's not out of anger or anything like that. Right. But after this point forward, you know, I have to deal with you for what you have shown me. Mm-hmm. If you want me to treat you differently, then you have to do differently.
Right.
And that's hard for people when you've been a certain way for so long, and now it's like, okay, you know, it's easier for them to say he's angry than to say, you know what, we ain't pull our weight, or right. whatever the situation right, may exactly. be. You know, he's angry, he's mad, we don't know why he's mad, but that's what it is. And so, you know, for those who, you know, I think that's another reason why people are scared to work on their purpose, because they're scared of the journey.
Right. And that's what it is. They're scared of the journey. They're scared of the disappointments that come along with it, because there's going to be many disappointments. There's going to be times you're going to be like, I don't know what I'm doing, or what am I doing?
Right.
There's been many times I'm yelling at this guy like, God, what's going on?
What is going on?
I know this is who I am.
Right.
We're the support.
Yeah.
You know, but.
Exactly.
You know, in those moments, those are just moments to build my character. For right. me to, and now get this, because my purpose is being a coach and doing what I'm doing, all of those things that I went through, now I have experiences to pull from to right. help people, to give to. I decoded it. I went through it.
Right.
I went in the trenches, experienced it. Now I can, they'll say, well, I'm experiencing this. Yeah, because now I know what you're experiencing because I went through it.
Right.
So I can help you by giving you the shortcuts. You don't have to go through this long
right.
process I went through
exactly.
to decode and get it. I got the code. Now here, take this code and run it.
Right.
Now you just go through it a lot faster than I had to.
Right.
And I'm willing to sacrifice myself to do that, because this is who I am. And I needed to sacrifice myself to experience all of those things, so I'll know how to decode it and give people codes so they can get out of it with the shortcut codes.
That makes sense.
It's like cliff notes.
That makes sense. Because, you know, one of the things I told my mom, and she was like, you know, we got, instead of crying about what we gonna do right now, no, about what's going on with America at this present moment and all this kind of stuff, my question is, what are we gonna do?
Exactly. That's my question.
What are we gonna do? Okay, people didn't vote. Okay. That's past tense now. Mm-hmm. What are we going to do? You know, because we can't worry about what they're doing so much, but we got to worry about what we're going to do and what the things we need to do to change so we can be better. So what, you know, what's your thought pattern? How can you change within yourself to elevate us as a race?
Right. Because do we need politics to put all of our money in a pot to get to buy food in bulk so we can save money? Do we need politics to move into homes together so we can save money and have more time?
Right.
Do we need a politician to put money in a money market fund? 10 people get a money market fund, put money in it, and the cash that it makes from that can cover all of our expenses?
Right.
We can be creative and do things, but the thing is, are we walking with enough integrity to be able to do that without trying to take the money? See,
because right.
you got to do the inner. There are many systems we can create and make work as a community, mm-hmm. but if we don't heal ourselves first, it will be destroyed. It
Absolutely.
Won't work. So, because someone's going to dip in the pot because insecure fear.
Right.
Right. So, what's the
we
fear?
Live by that.
We live, see, survival fear. So, until we do individual healing
mm-hmm.
within ourselves to heal all the reasons why we're in this fearful state, we won't be able to build anything.
Right.
Because something will happen to destroy it. Mm-hmm. But if you got 10 people trying to build something together and they all have these traumas that they haven't healed,
mm-hmm.
I guarantee it won't work. But if you got 10 emotionally responsible people or emotionally mature people building something together, guess what? It will be built. You know why? Because if you're emotionally mature, you can communicate
right.
outside of the ego.
Right.
If you're emotionally mature, you can walk, you can be, have integrity and honor for each other. If you're emotionally mature, you can solve issues amongst each other without fighting.
Right.
If you're emotionally mature, you can be open to other people's ideas without fighting for your one idea.
Right.
So if you're not emotionally mature, you can't build a community that will be fruitful. If you don't have emotional maturity, you can't be in a relationship that can be fruitful. So at the end of the day, we keep saying what we want, but we can't get what we want until we change who we are.
Right.
So to get what you want, you got to change who you are, bottom line. Right. But see, we want to point the politicians. They're not doing this. Or the women want to point at the men. The men ain't nothing. And then the men want to point at the women. The women ain't nothing.
Right.
No. Emotional maturity brings everything to the center.
Right.
And from that point is how you build.
Yep.
Heal, build, grow. Heal, build, grow. That's the process.
Right.
But people want to build before they heal. Mm-hmm. It's impossible.
Exactly.
This is the problem. We keep trying to build before we heal.
Right.
And as soon as we start taking three steps, it just crumbles.
Right.
And let's build, then we crumble.
And it's funny to me because, you know, you're a coach, you do emotional healing, and people are like, well, why would you have people who do similar things to us yourself on your show and you give them a platform? I say I'm not in competition with them.
Right, and that's how I feel. I don't look at other coaches as a competition.
I'm not.
You know, because everybody, first of all, is just like a message, and this I told a friend of mine earlier. A friend of mine has great insight, and I said, you should share your insight, because she said something, and I said the same thing, but in a different way. And I said, the way that you said it might connect with a certain type of people's thought process. The way I said it may connect with these people's thought process. People need to hear things in different ways.
Different ways.
So your coaching way or the way that you coach may reach a certain type of people. And the way I coach may reach a certain type of people. It's just like we all have different ways that we learn. Some people are audible learners. Some people are learn by just through experience. So you have different ways you learn. Same thing with coaching. So that's why we need different types of coaches, different type of healing modalities. So I'm all about coming forth to help heal the people, because I know if we don't heal, we can't build. So this is what I've been stressing for years. But everybody want to try to build something, and they think that, well, if we vote in the right politician or if we get our own land, everything will be okay. No, if you get your own land and you don't have emotional maturity, it's going to be chaos on your land.
Exactly.
So you got to heal, then go get the land.
Right.
Then operate out of emotional maturity. Then it will be a fruitful land.
Right. Amen. I agree 100%. And it's like, that's something, that, you know, even with like, the millennials, I think the millennials, like, you know, a lot of my friends got mad because the millennials didn't vote. I didn't have a problem with that, that they didn't vote. That's their right to either vote or not vote. And if they had a intelligent reason why they felt they didn't need to vote, who am I to say their opinion or their thought pattern was wrong? My thing was, you know, you say, people say, well, you know, you need to vote for the lesser of two evils. So you vote out of fear.
Exactly.
So, you know, it doesn't really make a difference. If I'm going to make a decision, I can't make my decision off of fear. So, you know, I'm not going to say, so if I voted for Hillary, I'm not going to say I voted for Hillary because she's the lesser of two evils. That's just who I wanted. But if I wanted Donald Trump, then I'm going to say I wanted Donald Trump. And not be fearful about one, the backlash of what our race gonna say for you vote for Donald Trump, for
right.
But then two, you know, I'm not voting out of fear. You know, I'm voting for who I feel is the best. And if I ain't think neither one of those two was the best, and I thought one of those Green Party people was the best, that's who I'll vote for. And then you'll say, people say, well, you vote for that person, it's like you vote for Donald Trump. I said, but no, that's who I felt was the best candidate. So who are you? Whose right is it for you to say my vote didn't really?
It's once again, the mob mentality destroys evolution every time. The mob mentality. And I don't have a mob mentality. So for instance, everything that I teach foundations. So for instance, even when I train energy healers, I teach them the foundations, and they take those foundations and build upon it and create their own way of doing it on top of the foundations. The foundation is what's important. Once the foundation is set, you can be a co-creator on top of the foundation.
Okay.
So I don't say you have to do it like this. You have to do energy healing like this. No, I say here are the foundations, and I teach them thoroughly, and then they create their own way of doing it on top of the foundations. And I feel like this is what we need to do when it comes to individuals. Let them be who they are. Let new opinions come in, because the thing is, I'm always open to other opinions, you know, because there have been plenty of times where I've been open to somebody say something to help me see something from a different perspective. I said, oh, wow. Like, I never thought about it like that. Now, I'm in a position where I'm evolving because of that. But if we allow mob mentality to beat us down without allowing ourselves to be open to new perspectives, we are literally stagnating ourselves as a culture, as a country, and as people, period.
I agree. So if someone was interested in becoming an energy healer and they want to go through you, what's the process?
Okay, now, here's the thing. I don't train just anybody.
Okay.
So I have to see that you're in your heart enough, in your heart space, your character, how you move. Why do you want to do energy healing? Because this is a great responsibility that comes with the way I teach. You know, so I feel I take responsibility for what I teach by being selective on who I choose to teach.
Okay.
You know, because the foundation of everything I do is love. So if that's not your foundation, and I can clearly see very well, I see through the veils of people. I can see your, I can read your body language, your eye movements, your energy. So you can say all of this and that, but I see you. So therefore, it's based off of what I see. If I see you're in your heart enough, I'll teach you.
Okay.
But if not, I won't.
So how long is the, if let's say it's me, and you feel, okay, I'm in my heart enough, and I say, okay, I want to do this, how long is the process?
Well, it depends. What's your experience with energy healing?
Okay.
I'll have to sit down and talk to you, because everybody's different. Now, most of the time, the people who come to me to train as energy healers already have experience in energy healing, and I just come and kind of tighten up what they're doing and take them to the next level.
Okay.
So I've had clients fly in, and I train them for a week, and we're like in the same place, and it's just like, and my teaching is very unorthodox. It's not like, for instance, I have a client flying from LA to train under me. She said, what are we doing tomorrow? I said, I don't know. She's like, what you mean you don't know? I don't know. Because when I literally, it's like a shamanistic approach. We would wake up and then we would just start talking. And then based off of what she says, I start teaching. And I use the environment as the classroom. So every time we would go out, things would happen, and I would teach based off of the moment. Because whatever's happening in that moment is what needs to be taught. Whatever's showing up needs to be, I need to teach from that moment. So that's how I work.
Okay.
So by like the third day, she started to get it. Like, oh, I see. Because I don't teach in formula. I teach in the moment.
Okay.
So how I teach you will be completely different how I teach another person, because it's going to be based off of your belief systems, where your blockages and your belief systems are, how you think, how, you know, what you, you know, every, what's going on in the moment. You know, we may take a walk in the park and do any, like, and I just teach. And every time I teach, I'll teach something, and then we'll go out and about, and then a circumstance will happen to reflect exactly what I was teaching every time. Something will happen to show, and I'll just look at them.
Okay. So if somebody, I know somebody had reached out to me, and they was interested, and let's say they had no experience, then how long is the process then?
Like I said, I would have to sit down and talk to them personally and see. You know, like I said, most of the people that I train are already healers. So in that case, I could just, I track people who already got, like, I say, you got the gift, I know, and I, it takes a week. But, like, it depends. Well, some, one person might take a month. It may take, you know, a little while. It depends on their belief systems. And also, when I'm training people, I'm also uprooting trauma, too, because the more powerful you are as an energy healer is based off of how clear you are. So I'm also, a lot of times when I'm training people, I'm triggering you, too. Because I'm challenging your belief systems, and I'm challenging, because we got to uproot all that stuff and get all the stuff out, because the stuff that you cling on to that's limiting you, mm-hmm. it's actually limiting the energy to come through you, because the more open you are by removing these limiting belief systems or subconscious trauma, the more energy can come through you to project as an energy healer.
Okay.
And the more powerful you are, the more clear you are, the more clear your vessel is.
Okay.
You see, so we have to do, not only do I train how to do the energy healing, I'm also uprooting a lot of stuff too to clear it out so you can be a more efficient vessel.
All right. That's okay. So I'll let that person know. I think he probably listening anyways, but I'll let the person know, because he had went on your website and everything. He was like really interested on this kind of stuff. And, you know, I had thought about it too, but
okay.
I'm going to have to figure that out, because, you know, that's, all that intrigues me.
Okay.
And, you know, I really believe in coming from, you know, a place of love. And I think my dad taught me that, you know, when you talk about truth, love, and righteousness, when you talk about God and the universe. So, you know, I don't think a lot of times if we learn to be intentional and do everything out of love, then it'll be better. Mm-hmm. But, you know, not out of fear.
Right.
Because like I tell people all the time, it's only two emotions, fear and love. Everything else stems from that. Mm-hmm. And I just think if we learn to stay out the fear zone so much and stay more in the love zone, we could do better and do greater things. And like what you said about us becoming a community, and us join together and do this stuff. That's why I said, like, that's why they don't really deal with the Asians. You know, they couldn't care less if the Asians voted or not, because they already know the Asians going to do.
They put their money together and they buy properties and they buy business. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They don't care who the president is. Mm-mm. They're getting it together. And go up to Duluth, they got their own plazas. You see what I'm saying?
They own bank and everything.
This is what I'm saying. So, we're complaining. What are we doing to create? The goal, well, the answer is creating something together. But right. See, we can't see that clearly because we've got too much trauma that we haven't addressed individually, mm-hmm. which branches out to collectively.
Right. And we use, you know, slavery and other things as a catalyst that could be a truth. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, we're making a conscious choice not to do anything about it. Because at the end of the day, we could still have these triggers from slavery.
Ooh,
but
let's go there. But go ahead.
But okay, why aren't you choosing to do something about it and do something different, you know, and mm-hmm. deal with those triggers? And so you could grow from it and learn from it.
But I want to show you something real quick.
Uh-huh.
Now, everything, you know, the saying "as above, so below,"
mm-hmm.
from the micro to the macro.
Right.
So I want to bring everybody through to really look. For a second, use your imagination. Now, remember before we were talking about someone accused you of like taking advantage of them sexually.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, there's something that a woman can say to trigger that trauma to happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, imagine if someone purposely put television programming on your station that you watch. Let's say you had one station to watch.
Mm-hmm.
And the programmers knew you had this trauma, and they continually showed you movies and news clippings that was about sexual harassment all day long. Wouldn't that continually trigger mm-hmm. that trauma?
Right.
Wouldn't it continually trigger it?
Now, right.
We're just talking about you in the, from the micro, just the micro.
Mm-hmm.
Trauma, trigger. So guess what? What if I told you that could be done on purpose to keep you stagnated and trigger you on purpose mm-hmm. so you don't move past it.
Right.
Now let's take it out to the macro.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, the whole community is watching this one channel. And all they show is police brutality and slave movies all day.
Mm-hmm.
Trigger. Now, every time you turn on the TV, that same trauma is being triggered. And guess what? Every time that trauma is being triggered, stagnation. Because it's a weight that's holding you back. You're not moving forth because someone is purposely triggering you on purpose so you don't move forward.
Mm-hmm.
So, You could look at it from an individual perspective and from a collective perspective.
Right.
So we have to start asking ourselves, why do certain news clippings keep being shown to us over and over again? Why do certain movies be made over and over again? There's a reason. We don't understand psychology.
Right.
So therefore, whatever it is that's triggering you on, because we're being triggered on purpose, and it's working. Right. Cut the TV off.
Right. And you see, most people who are in a different heart space and thought process don't watch a lot of TV.
Exactly. I don't own a TV. I don't watch television. I know it's programming to trigger, okay, on all different levels. So I'm just talking about black community. Mm. We triggered by the stuff they're showing us news. It's a reason why they're running certain news clippings over and over to trigger you.
Right.
And if you're, guess what? What happens when you're triggered? Are you conscious or unconscious?
Unconscious.
And if you're unconscious, how can you take control of your destiny? If you're unconscious, can't you be controlled?
Mm-hmm.
But if you're conscious, can you?
Nope. Nope.
There you go. So.
And I also feel they know that we live in a constant state of fear.
But they keep it, but we keep perpetuating. Yep. The thing is, we keep allowing ourselves to get triggered by watching it over and over and over. But we need to see what's going on in the world. Listen, there's a whole lot of good things going on in the world too, but they ain't showing you that.
They ain't showing you that.
It's going to always be something terrible happening in the world.
Right.
But you have to understand psychology. You have to understand how this human vessel works and how it works with the physical and emotional part of it.
Right.
When people understand psychology and look, it's like this. On a street level, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whoever the boss is that's running the dope game, he know what does he do? He keeps you in fear.
Mm-hmm.
Just like you watch The Godfather. Why did he put the horse, why did he chop the horse's head off and put it in that person's bed? To trigger them.
Right.
See, oh, he crazy. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So if you understand the psychology of that you're purposely being triggered, then you could be like, hold on. Right. I'm purposely being triggered.
Right.
Let me cut that off and start doing the opposite of what is being shown to me to trigger me. So if a black man is getting killed on television, when you go out and about, go hug a black man.
Right.
When somebody did someone else, do the opposite. This is what I teach my clients how to do. Become the alchemist. Mother Teresa said, don't invite me to a anti-war event or party, but if you invite me to a pro-love one, I'll come. Because she understood alchemy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. If you don't like something in the world, you create the complete opposite of it. And if you do that enough, it begins to eclipse what you don't like. But see, what we do is we keep looking at what we don't like, and we get triggered, and we get triggered. I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't like the world. The world is scary. I don't like the world.
Right.
I don't like the world. It's scary. On the other hand, I'm over here creating stuff to show the other side.
Okay, I'll give you an example. So I'm going to give you several. Like, this show is a way for us to create, to change the narrative of how people see us.
Right.
You know, to see two black men have an intelligent conversation, really deep intelligent conversation, that's not something that's being shown on TV.
Right. And see, now that we're on the internet, we're leveling that playing field. They can't stop us anymore. We're here.
Right.
So here's the thing. And I'm glad you brought that up, because I want to bring this up real quick. And I've been thinking about this for a while. There are many talented black screenwriters and filmmakers, but they don't get the time of day in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
They only put out certain type of black films.
Right.
On purpose. But here's what I think we finally realized this, because there is a channel on YouTube called Black and Sexy Television or something like that. What these brothers and sisters are doing is they're creating their own content, good shows. I watch some of them, good writing. They're finally realizing what I've known for years. I've been trying to say, we don't need Hollywood. We can get a 70D camera for $5,000 and shoot a whole movie ourselves. In the future, NBC, ABC, all these stations will not exist. You know what will exist? The Kevin Thornton station. If you got good content, people could be watching you instead of NBC, ABC, and CBS. We can take control of the entertainment.
If we expand our thought pattern and understand that the internet is the way for the future. So YouTube is the way for the future. So if you, if NBC, ABC, CBS, or Universal, they don't want your stuff, create it.
You ever hear the show Insecure?
Yep.
You know how she got that show?
Was she on YouTube or something?
She had a YouTube called The Awkward Black Girl, and it blew up. And see, Hollywood will come to you.
Come to you.
See, we trying to chase Hollywood when all we got to do is what I've been saying all along is be creators, be the creators that we are. And guess what? When it blows up, they'll come to us trying to give us our money. And you know what I'm saying? Keep your money. I'd rather be independent, get on ConnectPal, start my own subscription-based website like Dame Dash did, where you pay $6.99 a month. You can see all his films. We can do that. We can start a film company right now, create our own content. That's what Black and Sexy is doing. They got their own website, $6.99 a month. You can watch like 20 of their shows. See, now they're creating residual income.
Right.
We don't need Hollywood.
Right.
We don't need CBS. And they know this, and they're frightened, and they're all dinosaurs. They're dying.
Exactly, because if we could, that's going to pick it back to the Asians. If we get to the same point where we don't need them, because they that's the problem. They know we need them.
Exactly. Because we think we do.
Because we think we do.
We think we do.
We don't really need them, but we think we do. But if we know, we understand our power and step into our power and not, you know, just do what we need to do, the world is ours.
But we don't believe that we're creators, and this is one of the things that I'm trying to bring forth. We are creators, period.
Right.
If you're not, and when I say creators, I don't mean just the art, like film or movies, music. Creators, whatever it is that you're good at, you're being a creator. Whatever it is, we need to embrace ourselves as creators and create. Stop worrying about what Hollywood doing, what they doing. Just create and build together, period.
Right.
And then all of the people that you fighting go come try to come to you to get a piece of your pie.
Right.
But guess what? Now, we don't even need y'all money.
Right.
We can put in money to get a camera for $5,000. We can get on a website like Dame Dash and start a subscription-based website with our content.
Right.
Because I know a lot of good writers and filmmakers. We can create something hot. I got ideas all day. I got a movie script. It's nothing for me to create something.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So it's just a matter of us coming together and supporting each other, supporting good content, independent content.
Exactly.
And this is what Dame Dash been trying to get people to see for the longest.
For the longest. Yeah.
And he's leading the way with that subscription-based content on his website where you can watch all of his stuff. It's smart. And this is where we're going, and we're finally starting to see it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a beautiful thing.
Well, this has been a very great show. My time is almost up. So before I sign off, I want you to talk to the masses. Whatever's on your spirit at this moment, speak it to the audience.
Okay, so I want to reiterate on the concept of heal, build, grow. If we want to build something powerful, if we want power, you can't build anything powerful without being clear enough to build it and see it through clearly. And we can't come together as people if we're insecure, if our egos are too big, that we're not open to other ideas. And that's all part of the lack of healing, all of it. So you can talk all day about marching till your feet hurt. We can sit up here and say, let's get our own land. You can sit up here and say all these different things, but until we heal as individuals, which will leak out into being healing as a collective, we will not be able to build anything with a strong enough foundation to be fruitful.
Absolutely. And I thank you, sir. What a great way to start off the new year with the Wellness Architect Show. Thank you for all those who listening on Facebook Live and on the internet. Till next week, be great, be you, be authentic. We out. Peace.
Peace and love, y'all.
Man, I don't care. you killed that.
The biggest station in the world, playing all of today's hits. We're listening to Instinct Radio.